Go ahead, Mayor.
All right. Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome. Let's call to order our Lynnwood City Council meeting for the business meeting for this evening, Tuesday, November 12th, 2019. And if you would, Councilmember Cotton, lead us in the flag salute.
Let the allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Could we have the roll call, please?
Yeah. And I forgot the sheet, so I'll do it by memory. Mayor Smith.
Here.
Council President Goodwin.
Present.
Council Vice President Frizzell.
Here.
Councilmember Ross.
Here.
Councilmember Hurst.
Here.
Councilmember Sessions.
Happy to be here.
Councilmember Cotton.
Also happy to be here.
Councilmember Sutton.
Hello.
Council President Mayor.
Thank you. Moving on to item 30, this is the approval of our minutes. Councilmember Sutton, would you please do the honors? Would you please read the minutes for approval?
Okay. Approval of minutes. Finance Committee meeting, September 26, 2019. Business meeting, October 28, 2019.
Second.
Thank you. Are there any amendments or corrections? No? All those in favor of approving the minutes as submitted, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. Messages from the mayor. I just want to briefly talk about our long weekend. We had such a wonderful weekend honoring and celebrating our nation's heroes. On Sunday evening at the Lynnwood Convention Center, we hosted over 280 veterans and guests for a Veterans Appreciation Dinner, which included opening marks for myself and Councilmember and Air Force veteran Shannon Sessions, as well as the Korean Consul General, General Lee, who was presenting the Ambassador for Peace Medals of Recognition for those who served in the Korean War. And we had a special announcement to make that night because last Friday we learned that Lynnwood and our Veterans Park has been selected as the future home of a Gold Star Families Memorial Monument. And the purpose of the monument is to honor Gold Star families, preserving the memory of the fallen, and stand as a stark reminder that freedom is not free. Our Parks Department will be doing some major improvements to our Veterans Park, and the addition of this touching monument will ensure that Veterans Park truly is a location where we can honor all those who have served and those sacrificing everything. Additionally, we held our annual Veterans Day ceremony yesterday along with the VFW Post 1040 and the Northwest Junior Pipe Band. And Lynnwood remains committed to being a veteran supportive and welcoming community. But it was a great weekend. So with that, we'll move into citizen comments. Those of you who have signed up on the sheet will come forward, say what you would like to say to council and myself. You'll have 3 minutes to do so. State your name and address, and then share. And there's no one on the list. So is there anybody who would like to come forward for citizen comments? Mr. Heichel?
Council members, Mayor, Ted Heichel, 3820, 191st Place Southwest in Lynnwood. A couple of things that have come up that are of interest. One is later on in the meeting under business items, they'll be talking about having a salary commission ordinance rather than the council deciding what the amount of remuneration would be for the mayor and for the council. It will be up to a salary commission of 5 people in the community. We've tried it before. It hasn't worked, but let's try it again. The one thing I would like you to change in that ordinance that is presented to you tonight is the fact that the only time people can speak are at the 2 hearings which are scheduled anytime a recommendation from the commission comes forward to the council or comes forward as the law of the city. It would seem to me that in previous situations, you agreed that there should be a place documented in the ordinance for people to be able to speak at every meeting. And the reason I bring that up is that I'm concerned that by doing it this way, that you only get to talk at the hearings once the decision virtually has been made. It isn't giving the opportunity of people to have input early on in the process. So I would ask that you make that one change. Other thing I have to talk about tonight is the car tab fee. I know I'm talking to the city council, but you are also the Transportation Benefit District Board. And I give you my little sign here. I don't know whether you could put this up on the overhead or not. Can't do it. But it just tells you that the $30 car tab vote in Lynnwood by precincts, 70% or more of the people in three precincts voted in favor of the $30 tab fees. 65% or more in 10 precincts voted for it. 60% or more of the people in 15 precincts voted for it. Three precincts, 55% or more voted for the $30 tab fees. And more than 50% in one precinct voted for the tab fees. Now there was one precinct, I won't mention the name, where only 49.8% of the people voted for the $30 tab fees. That was one vote that went in the no column that swung that precinct. But I think you can see by the preponderance of people in the city of Lynnwood, they are in favor of the $30 tab fees. And I hope the council sitting as the Transportation Benefit District will take that into consideration and whether they want to fight the people in court to try to overturn the resolution of the people in their vote. And I would also like to suggest that there's more emphasis on when you're having a meeting, because I keep looking for that monument sign that is supposed to be built out in front of City Hall that will be able to tell the people when you have meetings and what you're going to discuss. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there others? All right. So we're moving on to our presentations. We have some exciting presentations and a proclamation to deliver this evening. I want to start off with 60.A. This is our annual presentation for honoring excellence and a great deal more. I want to tell you a little bit about the history. This will be our sixth year in honoring three people and companies in our community. We started back in 2014. The award is presented to a dedicated employee who demonstrates his or her work to both internal and external customers, a citizen who actively participates in our community and volunteers his or her time in a business, and a business that actively participates in our community. And we've had a really full, vibrant list of award recipients in the past years. I was thinking about reading their names. Is that a good idea? All right. So starting in 2014, the first group, the employee was Susan Burns, our citizen was Ed Dos Remedios, and our business was Acura of Lynnwood. 2015, the recipients were Bill Akiaga, Terry, the citizens, we had two, Terry and Elaine Solvang, and the business was Awards Services. In 2016, the employee was Amy Kirk, the citizen was Wally Webster II, and the business was Experience Momentum. In 2017, the employee was Connie Avalos-Gaylor, and the citizen was Gary Walderman, and the business was Norwest Kitchen and Remodel. And last year, our employee was Terrence Calhoun, our citizen was Monica Thompson, and the business was Chick-fil-A, with Paul Rosser accepting the award. So tonight, we're excited to be able to do these awards once again. The names are engraved on a plaque that sits in our city hall out there. And so this is how we'll do it. I am going to come down to the podium, and I am going to honor the staff person, and then other council members will be doing the citizen and the businesses. So, let me get the little... So Dale Schlack, will you please join me? We're going to model what the rest of you are going to do, just so you know. All right, so do it right.
Okay.
Honor and excellence and a great deal more. Whereas the City of Lynnwood honors excellence in its citizens, businesses, and employees for their contributions to the health and well-being of the city. And whereas the City of Lynnwood is a vibrant, welcoming community where our diverse population is actively engaged in shaping the city's progress as a leading marketplace of business and commerce, making it a perfect place to call home. And whereas the City of Lynnwood has an abundance of active community members, engaged businesses, and dedicated city employees who contribute to the overall vibrancy of this great city. And whereas Dale Schlack has been the Lynnwood Police Department's chaplain for over 17 years, serving local community members and Lynnwood Police Department employees during their times of need. And whereas Chaplain Dale Schlack always brings a caring, uplifting, and humble presence as he supports grieving family members through traumatic life events, responding alongside our police officers, firefighters, and paramedics. And whereas Chaplain Dale Schlack also supports members of the Lynnwood Police Department who are responding to significant and oftentimes distressing situations, ensuring that our first responders are on solid emotional ground and providing his guidance and listening ear when needed. And whereas Chaplain Dale Schlack is well known and well respected throughout our local faith communities and law enforcement communities, and he participates in Lynnwood's Cops and Clergy program, helping to build connections between faith leaders and the Lynnwood Police Department. And now, therefore, let it be resolved that we, myself, Nicholas Smith, and the Lynnwood City Council, do hereby proclaim that Dale Schlack is awarded the Honor and Excellence and a Great Deal More Employee Award. And we sincerely thank you, Dale, for your continued excellence and contributions to making Lynnwood a vibrant community that is a great deal more. Congratulations.
I just want to say thank you to all of you that serve our city so well, but especially I want to say thank you to Lynnwood Police Department, Chief Davis, for allowing me to be your chaplain, former Chief Jensen also, but just the men and women that serve Lynnwood Police Department and that serve this city so well, you have the best. So thank you so much. This is a great honor. And my grandsons are probably going to want to play with it.
Thank you.
All right, so, wow, congratulations. Vice President Frizzell will be delivering the Honoring Excellence and a Great Deal More to our citizen. And Lauren Simmons, would you please join Councilmember Frizzell at the podium?
It's my honor to honor this man tonight. Whereas the City of Lynnwood honors excellence in its citizens, businesses, and employees for their contributions to the health and well-being of the city, and whereas the City of Lynnwood is a vibrant, welcoming community where our diverse population is actively engaged in shaping the city's progress as a leading marketplace of business and commerce, making it a perfect place to call home. And whereas the City of Lynnwood has an abundance of active community members, engaged businesses, and dedicated city employees who contribute to the overall vibrancy of this great city. And whereas Lauren Simmons has a passion for serving the Lynnwood community, and he cares deeply about city government and the city members, the community members that we serve. Whereas Lauren Simmons has served on the Lynnwood City Council for 16 years, 8 of which he was elected to serve as president of the council. Whereas during Lauren's tenure on the City Council, he had countless accomplishments and has left a lasting legacy. And whereas currently Lauren Simmons serves on the City's Civil Service Commission, the Parks and Rec Foundation Board, the Snohomish County Planning Commission, and he has recently been appointed to the Public Facilities District Board. And whereas, in addition to his current volunteer roles, Lauren continues to be active in the community as a contributing writer for Lynnwood Today, a very frequent attender of city council meetings and city events, and a supporter of many local nonprofit organizations. And now, therefore, be it resolved that we, Mayor Nicholas Smith, and the Lynnwood City Council do hereby proclaim that Lauren Simmons is awarded the Honoring Excellence and a Great Deal More Citizen Award. And we sincerely thank Lauren for his continued excellence and contributions to making Lynnwood a vibrant community that is a great deal more. Signed, Nicholas Smith, Mayor, Benjamin Goodwin, City Council President.
I've become a blubbery idiot. I've had at least 14 speeches that I was going to prepare for you this evening. You'll be happy to know I'm down to about a third of one. But I do feel a little bit prompted to share an experience out of my life. I think it was back to the year of 1968. I, along with some others, attended the worship service at the Hollywood Presbyterian Church in Hollywood, California. The speaker that morning was a gentleman by the name, I can't even remember what his name is, that's how far it's been. But I do remember that he said on numerous occasions during the service, the times and tide of God are not the times and tide of men. And I've remembered that and thought about that and reflected on that far more than probably anyone might guess. And the simple conclusion that I came out with that is I don't understand why God always waits to the last minute to get things done. I say that because I sincerely believe that the last 4 or 5 years of my life have been the most stimulating and exciting and rewarding that I've experienced all my days. And for those of you who don't know me, thank you for coming. And for those of you who do know me, thank you for coming. And for those who might watch this or hear it somewhere along the line that were intending to come but were not able to make it, thank you for your intentions. Mayor, Council, it's been a great ride. And I truly feel honored to be given this award. Thank you.
Congratulations. Council President Goodwin is moving towards the podium, and we would like to invite the business that we're honoring tonight to join him, please. This is Mr. Klein, 76 Station, and Dan Kessel is the manager, and he's here to receive the award. And there's some big blue things in the back that I think are joining us. So don't be frightened from behind.
Well, thank you all. And I do want to quickly say how excited I am to be able to present this proclamation to the Mr. Clean 76 station. I'll read this, and then I want to quickly touch on something else that has to do with the proclamation as well. So the proclamation states, honor and excellence and a great deal more. Whereas the City of Lynnwood honors excellence in its citizens, businesses, and employees for their contributions to the health and well-being of the city. And whereas the City of Lynnwood is a vibrant, welcoming community where our diverse population is actively engaged in shaping the city's progress as a leading marketplace of business and commerce, making it a perfect place to call home. And whereas the City of Lynnwood has an abundance of active community members, engaged businesses, and dedicated city employees who contribute to the overall vibrancy of this great city. And whereas Mr. Clean 76 Station has been serving our local Lynnwood community for over 50 years with fast, friendly, first-class service. That is longer than I've been born. And whereas Mr. Clean 76 Station is a proud and active member of the Lynnwood, Snohomish County, and wider Puget Sound community, regularly attending local community events, And whereas Mr. Clean's 76 station hosts their own events for community members, such as numerous holiday events and customer appreciation days. And whereas Mr. Clean 76 station is a proud and active member of the Lynnwood Chamber and the Economic Alliance of Snohomish County. And now, therefore, be it resolved that we, Mayor Nicholas Smith, and the Lynnwood City Council, do hereby proclaim that Mr. Clean's 76 station is awarded the Honoring Excellence and a Great Deal More Business Award. And we sincerely thank Mr. Clean's 76 station of Lynnwood for their continued excellence and contributions to making Lynnwood a vibrant community that is a great deal more. Signed, Nicholas Smith, Mayor, and myself, Benjamin Goodwin, City Council President. Thank you. So let's give them a hand. And just to attest to the customer events and the appreciation days, if you notice, there was a event at the convention center for small businesses. This was given away, but on the back states family photos for Halloween, mentions that Santa is coming soon, and also free car washes for vets on Veterans Day. So there are just three separate activities that they do for the customers and for the citizens. So thank you again for the work that you do.
I would like to take just thank you very much. I haven't been there that whole 50 years. I've been there 37 though. It's been there since I was 19. I love it like it's my own, and I appreciate all of our customers. We have the best customers in the city of Lynnwood, and we definitely have the best police department. And I wish I didn't have to call them as much as I do, but I'm glad they're there and I do. And but I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Are you in?
Oh, I'm getting old. There we go. Okay.
Immediately?
Oh, thank God. All right. I never heard the end.
Thank you, Karen.
And just so that you can see, this is the plaque with the newest additions here at the bottom, and this will be hanging in City Hall. So.
All right. I hope you all stay. We have one more proclamation this evening. Yes, ma'am, sir. Before they walk out, if you can catch them and organize them. They're right there. Oh, they're all three here. Wally Webster, the photographer, wants a picture of all three of you.
That's right, that's right.
Thank you. Thank you. So one more proclamation tonight. Today we have a proclamation for Transgender Day of Remembrance. And Councilmember Sutton will make her way to the podium, and I think Christine Cummings, you're here to receive it, I think, tonight, aren't you? Yeah, so if you could join Councilmember Sutton at the podium, that'd be great.
Madam Mayor, City Councilors, I feel very honored to be receiving this today. Okay, can you hear me now?
That's better.
Okay, Madam Mayor and City Councilors, I'd like to thank you for this honor. It's come at a very good time because this is the fifth year I produced this public service event. It's a chance to honor all the transgenders who've lost their lives prematurely in the last year. And I find it, the proclamation, well, November 23rd is our next Transgender Day of Remembrance. So I'm going to make sure that this proclamation is put on display on the reception desk for all the public that comes in so they can see it. And again, thank you for supporting our event, our community service event, and we look forward to many more years of producing this event as part of an international memorial. Thank you.
Thank you. So Christine, stay there while Councilmember Sutton reads your proclamation.
Proclamation. Recognition of Transgender Day of Remembrance. Whereas our nation is founded upon and is guided by a set of principles that includes that every person has been created equal, that each has a right to their life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, and that each shall be accorded the full recognition and protection of the law. And whereas the City of Lynnwood is committed to being a safe, welcoming, and equitable community for all people, regardless of race, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, age, sexual orientation, gender identification, country of origin, or any other identity, and whereas the Transgender Day of Remembrance is a worldwide event set aside to remember those who were killed because of the transgender hatred or prejudice. And whereas this day of remembrance begun November of 1999 and was started to honor Rita Hester, a transgender woman murdered in 1998. And whereas this day of remembrance serves to publicly mourn and honor the lives lost to transgender hatred and prejudice and to raise awareness of hate crimes against the transgender people. And now, therefore, it be resolved that we, Mayor Nicholas Smith, and the Lynnwood City Council proclaim November 23rd, 2019, as Transgender Day of Remembrance, and we call upon all people of Lynnwood to join us in honoring those lost to hatred and stand with us to ensure that all members of our community feel safe and welcomed in Lynnwood. Signed, Nicholas Smith, Mayor, and Benjamin Goodman, Council Member, President.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any written communications or petitions? Let's move on to item 80. This is where our council gets to make their comments and announcements. And Councilmember Ross, looks like we're starting with you.
All right. Well, that's a hard act to follow, isn't it?
Yes.
So I'm just going to briefly talk a little bit about the upcoming Art of Food and Wine. This is our second annual event. It's going to be Saturday, February 8th at the Convention Center. Tickets are on sale now. Be sure you come because they're going to have even more things than they did last year and more food, which will be great. So it's a wonderful event, and it raises money for the foundation, I believe. So come, February 8th, Food and Wine. Wonderful event last year. It's going to be even better this year. Hope to see you there.
Councilmember Hurst.
All right. Thank you very much. This is a great evening. I really enjoy honoring excellence. Now, those mascots were named Drip and Dot. Drop. Drip and Drop. And I thought we were going to have Dip and Dots ice cream, so I was really kind of excited, but, you know, it's disappointing. But still, just those three awards, it's just really great. Chaplain Schlack, every National Night Out, we see him. The 76 station on on 44th gas pump number 9 is my pump. And then Lauren. Oh, Lauren. Before I ran for city council, I had breakfast with Lauren, and he gave me probably 5 books to read. But the one that I liked the most was about budgeting for cities. And I think it's just so apropos tonight that Lauren is honored, and I just appreciate the guidance that he has given myself and lots of others in his wisdom. So it was a great evening. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Councilmember Sessions.
Yes, agreed. What a fun evening to honor excellence, and just so pleased that we're continuing this and making it a priority. Thank you, Mayor and staff. What to say about Dale Schlack. I had the honor of working with him at the police department, and I have the honor of working with him now with Support 7 and South County Chaplains. And he is a class act and just really a special human. Yes. And Lauren, just a mentor and a light in our community and so deserving. And oh boy, I do love that business. Those folks over there are just positive, friendly, community-oriented. Thank you for honoring them. So a few things for me. Yes, what a wonderful, great Veterans Weekend. The events that were happening, I just love that. I'd like to bring your attention to Albert Community Church has an annual production. This is the second time that they're using our history and heritage as part of their Christmas play. It's 1962 World's Fair Christmas and the Bubble Eater. So those of you who remember that, at our History and Heritage meeting today, this afternoon, if you didn't know, maybe you already know, but the actual Bubble Eater is was bought and being used as a greenhouse over in South Seattle area or something like that. You could look it up, but I thought that was pretty interesting. And anyway, this is the basis of our production over there. And it was written by a local screenwriter who also wrote our Aldwood Manor Christmas play that was a couple years ago. So if you'd like to learn more about that, Aldwood Community Church, it's always the first weekend in December, the Friday, 2 shows on Saturday, 2 shows on Sunday. And they're free tickets beginning November 24th. You can go to the Albert Community Church website to get more information, or you can also ask me. And then also, I just wanted to bring your attention, again, through the History and Heritage Board, that Cookies with Santa is from 1 to 4 on December 8th over there at Heritage Park. And that's a fun little tradition that a lot of our families partake in. So just want to let you know. Thank you for being here tonight.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. Yes, I'll just echo sentiments on the high quality of folks we have here in the city, businesses and staff and residents. My comments really tonight are just one is a reminder that this coming November 20th, as was mentioned by one of our residents here at the podium, on the 20th at 6:30 we'll be starting our Transportation Benefit District Board. One of the things we will be discussing at that meeting is the budget for the TBD and how we will be approaching potentially some gaps created by the initiative that looks like it's passing. So if you're curious and interested and want to speak to us there and then, as well as anytime we have one of these meetings, you can come to the podium. But November 20th at 6:30. And then also just a reminder, as the cold weather sets in, now is really a great time that if you think of it to bring a donation by the Lynnwood Community Food Bank. You can look them up at www.lynnwoodfoodbank.org. They have delivery and drop-off donation times listed there. Their location is at 5320 76th Avenue Southwest at 98037. And then also, if you're looking to do something fun that also benefits the community, the Turkey Trot 5K is on the 28th of November, and it is at the Edmonds Community College, and that is a benefit for the food bank as well. So if you don't think to clean out your lagers and bring some cans by the food bank proper, you can also maybe run off some of the holidays and benefit the food bank as well. That's all for me. Thank you.
Councilmember Sutton.
I just want to say hello again and welcome, and I'm glad to have you here. Hopefully you'll continue to come and join us.
Council President.
Thank you. I have two matters that I would like to mention. First, Council Vice President Christine Frizzell and I serve on the, aside from the City Council, we also serve as representatives on the Regional Fire Authority as commissioners. The commission, or the board, is searching for a new fire chief. We have three candidates lined up, and this Thursday from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., the public is invited to come to the RFA headquarters on Meridian Avenue in Everett. That's the old Fire District 1 headquarters, to meet those three candidates. It's just a meet and greet, so it's a chance to get to know those three that are right now in contention to be the new fire chief for the RFA. Secondly, I know that the mayor and some others have talked about the Veterans Day dinner on Sunday night. I was unfortunately not able to attend, but I did hear that they offered a delicious menu of fried chicken, mac and cheese, and I think tri-tip, brisket. And it was an enjoyable time had by all. Apparently you don't know the story about that. Shall I tell?
Sure.
Or just leave people guessing?
It's just kind of weird. Yeah, you should explain it.
All right. Well, I heard from a birdie that there was a nice dinner planned, and there was a menu that was available, and one of our council members, our dear council member Sessions, decided to help the MC and took it upon herself to find the menu and give it to him so that he could tell the audience what was for dinner. Just so happened it actually was the menu for the event upstairs. And so when people were not served their macaroni and cheese, they actually got a little upset about that.
Councilmember Sessions.
If I may, since we're on point, yes, I did do that. And, oh boy. When you promise fried chicken, brisket, and macaroni and cheese, I mean, it was a beautiful meal, but it wasn't brisket, fried chicken, and macaroni and cheese. You know, you got veterans, people that get their bellies ready, and that's not what it is. Needless to say, lunch at Heroes Cafe next month is going to be macaroni and cheese.
That's all that I have, Mayor. Thank you.
As the Vice President for so.
And I was at that event, and I really did miss the mac and cheese, but I'd had leftover mac and cheese for lunch, so I was good. In this season of elections and Veterans Day and just kind of thinking about our country,
I was drawn to a video of a red skeleton. And many in this room, I hope even President Goodwin might remember Red Skelton. And I wanted to read something that he spoke on the Red Skelton Hour, January 14th in 1969. He says, "I remember this one teacher. To me, he was the greatest teacher, a real sage of my time. He had such wisdom. We were all reciting the Pledge of Allegiance, and he walked over. Mr. Laswell was his name, and he said, 'I've been listening to you boys and girls recite the Pledge of Allegiance all semester, and it seems as though it is becoming monotonous to you. If I may I recite it and try to explain to you the meaning of each word? I, me, an individual, a committee of one, pledge, dedicate all my worldly goods to give without self-pity, allegiance, my love and my devotion, to the flag, our standard, Old Glory, a symbol of freedom. Wherever she waves, there is respect, because your loyalty has given her a dignity that shouts, freedom is everybody's job. Of the United, that means we have all come together. States, individual communities that have united into 48 great states, 48 individual communities with pride and dignity and purpose, all divided with imaginary boundaries, yet united to a common purpose, and that is love for country. And to the Republic. Republic, a state in which sovereign power is invested in representatives chosen by the people to govern. And government is the people, and it's from the people to the leaders, not from the leaders to the people. For which it stands, one nation. One nation, meaning so blessed by God, indivisible, incapable of being divided, with liberty, which is freedom, the right of power to live one's own life without threats, fear, or some sort of retaliation, and justice, the principle or quality of dealing fairly with others, for all, which means, boys and girls, it's as much your country as it is mine. And now, boys and girls, let me hear you recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Since I was a small boy, two states have been added to our country, and two words have been added to the Pledge of Allegiance under God. Wouldn't it be a pity if someone said that as a prayer, and that would be eliminated from schools too? Just encourage us tonight to think about being united. There's been a lot of divisiveness across our country and in our community. And as I sat at the Veterans Day dinner, I was so overcome with emotion that I couldn't speak. Just thinking of all that our veterans had gone through to give us the life that we have. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Well, that was a closer. Thank you. We'll move on to item 90. We have business items and other matters. Council President Goodwin, if you would please do the honors with the unanimous consent agenda.
I would do those honors. I don't have anything here that says it, but would any member of the council like to remove any item from the consent agenda?
Councilmember Sessions?
Yes, please. I'd like to remove A, confirming Planning Commissioner candidate Christine Eck, and we will deal with that right after.
Councilmember Cotton?
Thank you, Your Honor. I'd like to remove Resolution of City Finance Policies 2019 update.
Thank you. Anything else?
Item B, I take it.
Okay.
All right. My job has been cut in half. So with that,
City Council adopt the following. Item C, Project Agreement, City of Lynnwood and Washington State Heritage Capital Projects Fund Grant Agreement. Authorize Mayor to enter into an agreement with the Washington State Historical Society for up to $124,000 in grant funding for the Heritage Park Renovation Project. And D, Voucher Approval. Approve claims and payroll in the amount of $2,596,957.29 and $1,123,410.28 respectively.
Thank you. The consent agenda will be adopted as read. If we'd like to go back to A, Councilmember Sessions, did you want to speak to that, or is liaison good? Or do you want liaison Goodwin to the planning
board? That's a good idea.
I think that's a good idea.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you for the option.
Then what I will do first is move to confirm Christine Eck to the Planning Commission. Confirm appointment of Christine Eck to position number 2 on the Planning Commission. That term expiring on December 31st, 2020.
Second.
And all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. And Chris, we'd like to invite you to come forward so we can do a photo of you as well, as promised. And congratulations and thank you.
Come down. Good to see you again. Thank you, Christine.
Okay, Councilmember Cotton, would you like to speak to the resolution on city financial policies 2019 update?
I would love to. Resolution number, please. It's 2019-10, correct?
Correct.
All right. I move the adoption of Resolution 2019-10, a resolution of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, amending the City of Lynnwood financial policies.
Second.
And would you like to speak to the resolution?
I would absolutely love to, Your Honor. Thank you. So the person that really gets a lot of credit for this work is Corbett Locke, our strategic planner with the city. You know, being part of the finance committee for the past 5 years, realizing that we didn't have a good policy on how we decided we were in trouble financially. That was kind of a lesson that came out of the last recession, was we kind of realized too late. I think someone acknowledged that we were in trouble and we needed to take action. And so Corbett's done an amazing amount of work with the help of Director Springer and the Finance Committee, really just kind of there to give him a nod and provide some feedback. But he's done some really good work here to safeguard our tax dollars so that in the event that there is a financial downturn, we don't sit up here and wring our hands and say, oh goodness, what do we do? We go, let's go to the financial policy and let's do what the plan says. And so I kind of pulled this really so that we could communicate to you, our neighbors, what we're doing in the city to really make sure that we don't get out over our skis next time we have a recession or some kind of economic downturn that impacts our tax revenues to the point where we react too late. So that's kind of why I wanted to pull it, and my hat's off literally and figuratively to Corbett Locke and Director Springer for their work on this.
Thank you. Any other discussion? All right. All those in favor of passing Resolution 2019-10, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposition? So passed. All right, we have two public hearings this evening that we will engage in next. Under other business items, after 90.3A, the Salary Commission Ordinance, after you have taken care of that business, I'd like to move new business up under that, because we do have an executive session with two topics and we can adjourn from the executive session. Is there any other new business that anyone needs to bring forward? There's one, the Housing Task Force is under new business tonight. Anything else? Okay, So let's move forward with our public hearings. 90.2A, this is our public hearing on the 2019-2020 budget modifications. So at this time, the City Council and I will conduct a public hearing on the mid-biennial modifications to the adopted budget for 2019-2020. Thank you for attending and participating this evening. The purpose of the public hearing is to allow the public to express their views on matters under consideration by City Council. Decisions will not be made until after citizens have had the opportunity to share their views. Adopting and modifying the city's budget is a legislative action, and common rules for legislative public hearings apply. Public hearings must be fair and free of conflicts of interest. Before we start the proceedings, and this also applies to myself, does any council member have any conflict of interest regarding this matter? Now the public hearing is officially open. The sequence of tonight's public hearing will be as follows. One, city staff will provide an oral report that summarizes the matter at hand. Next, the City Council may ask clarifying questions specifically related to staff's presentation or the written information provided. Third, members of the audience will be invited to come to the lectern to share information you wish the Council to consider. I will first call from the speakers from the sign-up sheet that was located outside the chamber's entrance, and then next I will call for speakers who have not signed up. After the public testimony portion of this hearing, I'll invite City staff to offer clarifying information responsive to public comments. The City Council then may ask clarifying questions of the speakers, specifically related to their testimony. Citizen responses must be made from the lectern. After each citizen has had the opportunity to speak and the City Council is ready to begin its deliberation, I will close the public hearing. And after the hearing is closed, the City Council can begin its deliberation and ultimately determine what action should be taken. As Mayor, it's my role to facilitate the hearing and Council's deliberation. It's important that public hearings are conducted in a manner that is equitable to all. We'll use the following ground rules for this public hearing. Written materials and electronic recording of this meeting are being made. When coming to the lectern, speakers should state their name and address. Please speak into the microphone so others can hear you. Comments may only be made from the lectern. Only one person may speak at a time. Speakers will be allowed up to 3 minutes to share their views. When multiple people in the audience are represented by one spokesperson, as demonstrated by a show of hands, the council will consider the testimony to be from each of those persons. If the spokesperson speaks on behalf of the others, I will grant the spokesperson an additional 2 minutes to speak. I may adjust the order of speakers when doing so supports the purpose of the hearing. Everyone's asked to respect opinions that differ from yours and to help ensure members of the audience are not intimidated or discouraged from expressing their views. The purpose of this hearing is to receive citizen input. This is not the time for back and forth discussion or for debate. This public hearing is underway, and I will now ask Finance Director Sonia Springer to provide an overview of the topic at hand.
Thank you. The City of Lynnwood adopts a biennial budget process of biennial budget 2019-2020, and RCW requires that before the first year of that, the end of the first year of that budget, which is the end of 2019, that we have budget modifications. We've gone through a process, identified any significant items that weren't known about when we adopted the budget last year. So in this particular case, we don't have very many, but we do have some budget modifications that are required to be made to the city's budget. Throughout the year, we do have budget amendments, which are a different process. This budget modification process is much more structured and has a public hearing and so forth. So I will go ahead and proceed with the list and the identification of the budget modifications that are being requested. So basically, this year for 2019, the budget modifications are in four different categories. One is there's four budget modifications for the general fund, which I'll go over in more detail in subsequent slides. There's also some other governmental funds budget modifications. There's some utility fund budget modifications, which includes an addition of an FTE, a senior engineering technician, for the stormwater program. And then finally, there's some capital funds budget modifications. The first large general fund budget modification is a revenue. The Wickers building was vacated by the Visitors Information Center earlier this year, so that's available to rent, and the Parks, Rec, and Cultural Arts Department would like to rent that out. So they're anticipating about a $500 increase to their park rental revenues to rent that out. And before the end of the year, early December specifically, we'll be having a fee ordinance reviewed and passed to adopt the rates that will be charged to rent the Wickers building at Heritage Park. There are three budget modifications to the general fund. One is the same Wickers building. Right now it doesn't have any furnishings. It needs some tenant improvements. We need to put Wi-Fi service in there. We need to create new park brochures that show that that building is available to be rented. So the total cost of the furnishing and tenant improvements and Wi-Fi is about $7,000. So the Parks, Rec, and Cultural Arts Department is requesting $7,000 budget modification to do that. The second item is, unfortunately, on July 24th, third, some thieves went and vandalized the copper wire at Meadowdale Playfields. We had to repair that at a cost of $15,400. That was not in the budget, and so we would like to propose to amend the budget for $15,400 to pay for those repairs. And finally, all the boards and commission members, they don't currently have email addresses, they don't have name tags, they don't have business cards and so forth, so we're requesting $15,800 to pay for the 60 board and commission members' cost for that. So in total, the general fund expenditure adjustments is $38,200 for this biennium. And this is a summary of the general fund budget modifications. The first one is a revenue of $500. The total expenditures, $38,200, with a net decrease to the general fund of $37,700. So that puts the modified ending fund balance of the general fund $4.25 million. The second category relates to other general government funds, not the general fund. The first one is to the EDIF fund, which are Economic Development Infrastructure Fund. It's just it's a change of the use of that fund. We're going to increase the transfer to Fund 360, which is a transportation fund of $1,030,000, and decrease the transfer to the Fund 357 of other governmental capital, the same amount. And this is to accommodate the purchase of right-of-way for the 196th Street project. So that's just a change of funding to fund it out of the capital fund for transportation as opposed to general government. The second other general government fund proposed modification is to transfer $150,000 to facilitate the purchase of the city's replacement of the city's network core switch. If we don't have a good working network core switch, the whole system goes down, the phone system goes down, the website goes down. That happened to us a few months ago and it was scary. So we need a backup plan. So we're proposing to transfer $150,000 to accommodate the purchase of that from Fund 224, which is one-time monies. We don't need that fund anymore. We're paying off the debt that relates to. And so the third fund that's being modified is the Information Technology Reserve Fund 520, and that is to transfer in that $150,000 from the Fund 224, and then to increase expenditures of the 520 fund to pay for the purchase of the network core replacement. It's about 8 years old, it's towards its end of life, and it needs to be replaced. So we're proposing to fund that. And the third category is utility funds, proposed budget modifications. When we were ticking in time looking at the budget, we noticed that there was an error in the revenue budget for the sewer fund of almost $8 million. It was just a calculation error. We want to correct that. So it doesn't impact the bottom line. It was a mathematical error. And then finally, in utility fund, we're proposing to add a senior engineering technician, and that is to make sure that we can receive our NPDES permit. In the recent rate study, it was identified that we need two FTEs to handle this work, but currently we only need one position for 2020. So we're requesting one position at a cost of $142,000. And finally, there are some capital funds. It's really complicated, but we're not adding any new projects. We're changing the funding source for Capital Development Fund 333, other General Government Capital Improvement Fund 357. They're just a wash. And then also the Transportation Capital Fund to change the funding of that. We had talked about that earlier, about changing the transfer to EDA fund to go to the 196th Street project. So the corrections to the capital funds are really not adding any new projects, or just changing the funding to accommodate the capital funds. And here's some more that are related to the previous ones. It's increasing and decreasing funding to these various projects. It was found late during the project of the Meadowdale Playfields funding that we could not use REIT funds, so the $133,000 is to replace the funds that we couldn't use out of the REIT funds. And finally, the last capital fund is to increase capital expenditures for various projects of $561,000 that are funded through the utility funds. So this is a summary of the process that we've gone through for the budget modifications. The Finance Committee reviewed them on October 24th. There was a council work session review on November 4th. This is the public hearing here today to talk about the budget modifications. And then the council can opt to again meet on November 18th. The ultimate goal is to pass the budget modifications on the property tax levy ordinance by November 25th.
Thank you. Does any member of council have any questions to clarify information provided during the staff presentation or in your written materials? Councilmember Cotton?
Director Spring, with regard to the repair cost to the playfield, my memory is that because that was a partnership with the City of Edmonds and the school district, part of that contracting was that the maintenance and repair would fall to the City of Lynnwood for the benefit of the use of those areas. Are you remembering
that? That's correct, because okay. We had to shut down the use of the fields at night because the lights couldn't work. And so it's impacting revenue and play and everything. So the City of Lynnwood opted to repair that as soon as they could to get the balls back rolling.
Excellent. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Are there any new written materials or correspondence? So now I'd like to invite members of the audience to come forward to speak, starting with those who signed up. Again, no one signed up for this, so is there anyone who would like to speak to the budget modifications? Carrie Lonergan-Drake.
Yes, good evening, Council. Carrie Lonergan-Drake, address on file. So I'm curious why getting name tags and emails for 60 people is going to cost $15,800. If I did a math, that's $263 per person. I run a small business, which essentially is like a nonprofit. We had very small profit margins. So I'm very frugal when I'm making these kind of purchases, and I know that it should not be costing that much money for emails. I mean, aren't the emails going to be put in by staff? And that seems really high to me. And I think it's just one example of not enough belt tightening going on here in this city. As I was walking in tonight, I saw the sign above the entrance that said, Lynnwood, a great deal more. I'm really starting to think it's Lynnwood, a great deal more taxes. and it's really bothering me. Thank you.
Ted Heichel.
Oh, I like that Ted Heichel address on file. The question I had was about Utility Fund 411. It says here that it was overestimated apparently by $7,871,000. And in the line in your packet, it says, correction to budgeted sewer revenue. The calculation for sewer revenue was erroneously doubled for the biennium. And the next sentence says that the figure for the biennium was $30,658,000, and it should be $22,787,000. Now, if the amount was doubled from 22, it should be 44 million, and it's only 30 million. I don't understand the discrepancy there, and I really have a problem with overestimating $7 million worth of revenue that wasn't going to come in, and why it hasn't been caught, or if it was caught earlier, what date was it caught? And I realize that this is a one-time-a-year thing where you make these budget modifications, but that's a really big error. And again, is it supposed to be $44 million, $30 million, $22 million? Can the staff please give an explanation of how that figure came about and how it is being resolved? Thanks.
Any other comments? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Mila Tanner, and I live at 17631 32nd Avenue West in Lynnwood. And my first question is about the stolen wire at Meadowdale. Are these fields not insured? I mean, I guess my question really is, because if they're insured, then we should be getting paid back, for the wire, first of all. And the other thing that bugged me was the $15,000 for the email and the business cards. I get it. Everybody wants business cards and placards, but that really is a lot of money for business cards and email. Gmail works. I know that you guys still have email, general, online. You guys get online, right? You know, with the city. I'm just really worried about my property taxes, seriously. I'm a single mom. I work every day. 10% is a lot for my property taxes to go up living here in Lynnwood. Hell, I wouldn't have moved here if I would have known that it was going to go up this much constantly. You know, and $15,000, I'm thinking, that's a lot of money for some business cards, and I'm struggling to come up with the $5,000 for this year's taxes. So all I'm asking is just to please look at these numbers and just use just a little bit of common sense. Like, if you can just take it down a notch, you know, is all I'm asking, because it's hard. Thank you.
Could you please give me your first name?
Mila, M-I-L-A.
Thank you. Are there others who'd like to speak to the budget modifications? Yes, sir.
Greetings. I'm Pastor Judson Bartels at 19027 40th Avenue West. As well as being a pastor, I also own a small business, and I've got six kids at home. oldest one is 9. What that means is that we have to be really frugal with our income. And it's really difficult as the sole provider, the sole wage earner, living in the greater Seattle economy, even though the economy is doing reasonably well, to be able to feel like I can adequately provide the life that my family deserves. And I've lived in Lynnwood since 2009, so I'm 10 years in on this thing, and what I keep saying is that our cost of living keeps going up, and our benefits don't go up. So we travel regularly for big holidays and events, 4th of July and things like that, to other cities because they put on things that we don't do. And I'm not asking you to do those events, but what I am saying is we have some of the highest sales tax in the entire state. We have some of the highest property tax. The cost of living in this city, considering the very little amount that we get for it, it's just really a bad deal for citizens. And so we need to actually start to tighten our budget, because when you take money out of my pocket, you're taking it from my family, you're taking it from my kids. And I take that very seriously. And so it's something that I believe that as citizens, we need to stand up and say no. Because when the income isn't there for my family, I have to tighten my belt and I have to say no. And I think it's time that citizens tell the city, if the budget isn't there, cut something. You don't get to take my money. You don't get to take my family's money. Because we've earned it. I'm all about paying what we should pay to make the thing run. Furthermore, I just want to say, if you want to pay $150,000 for some internet service or $15,000 for business cards, I'm a small business owner. I can do those things. And I could do them cheaper. And I'd be delighted if you guys wanted to let me know. And I'd be delighted to help you save some money in those respects. Okay? Thank you very much.
There are others this evening? Yes.
Thank you, Mayor. Mark Drecke, address on file. And I just want to reiterate briefly, I will save my comments for after the levy tax public meeting. And just to reiterate that budgeting for priorities is not something I've seen by this council, and as a citizen, as a constituent, I've seen my taxes go up, and it is disturbing. The rate of increase, when you start to add in ST3 and Fire District 1 that was supposed to put money back into us and yet cost us additional money, there's example after example, and if you look at the general trend of our general fund, it's a pretty steep decline, and the solution can't always just be raise revenue by raising taxes on the constituents. Thank you.
Are there others? Okay, city staff, that would be you, Director Sonia. Could you offer any clarifying information in response to the citizen testimony?
I think the first issue that was raised was the boards and commission members' costs for business cards and email. I think the most significant part of that cost was the email addresses and getting set up for accounts for the boards and commission members. Just wanted to point that out, that it wasn't just the business cards and name tags. So that was the most significant. And when you get a city's infrastructure costs, it does cost to have the email accounts added for each of the 60 members. I think the second item that was raised was the theft at the Meadowdale Playfields. We do have insurance. Our deductible is $25,000. So this cost of $15,400 was not covered by insurance. That was why it was requested, because the Parks and Rec Cultural Arts Committee, or Cultural Arts Department, does not have budget for replacing and fixing that unless it was higher than, they don't have $25,000, they don't have $15,400 to fix that. So that's why they're requesting that budget modification for that. The utility revenue errors, that made it wasn't double, but it should have been 30 million It should have been 22 million, not 30 million, and it was a number crunching error that was done at the last part of tying up the budget. And who found it was our FCS consultants who's doing the rate study, and they said, wow, why are your show revenues jumping up in 19 and 20 compared to previous? And it was discovered that there was actually a calculation error, so it was about an $8 million error. It doesn't affect the general fund, it doesn't affect your taxes, it's the utility funds, it was a correction of an error. So I think those were the questions that I could address at this time.
Thank you. Does any member of council have a question to clarify information provided by the public or staff? Council President?
Thank you. In regard to the email that we have, is there a particular reason why we don't have the commissioners have a Gmail account or something like that that you can answer for us? Because I think I know the answer, but I don't know the answer.
IT okay. Director would know the answer, but I don't know the answer. Okay.
If I'm not mistaken, it has to do with the open public meetings. Yeah, is maybe Attorney Larson can answer.
Well, I can't address any of the technical aspects of it at all, but I can say from a legal standpoint, I think it's important that the board and commission members have a city email address, however that is going to be set up, so that their city communications can all be consolidated with the city's records. It would help a lot from a legal standpoint responding to public records requests.
Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton?
I think President Goodwin kind of drove where I was going with the cost of the emails, and that we have staff time that's essentially allotted to every email account to manage those public record requests so that we don't be found out of compliance, which costs money as well, right? The other one is with regards to the utility. I believe this came up in the work session, but because it was brought up during the FCS study, this reduction in revenue doesn't impact our rate study, right? So we're not saying, oh no, there's not $7 million, we need to raise rates. Is that correct?
You're absolutely correct. It was just a typo error, it was a calculation error, and they found it right away. It was a clearing error, but yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Any other questions, Council? Yeah, Councilmember Hurst.
Just a comment on the emails and business cards for the commissions, because I had brought that up as a need, just because we want to protect our volunteers that serve on boards and commissions. And if we get a public records request and some of that communication went into their private emails, then their entire private emails become public record. And so we just want to make sure that those citizens who volunteer to serve our city are protected. And there is turnover in our boards and commissions too. So it's not just we're going to do this, this is all cost for one time. I'm sure it's a rolling cost because terms expire and all that. So yes, it does seem high, but at the same time, if we don't do it, the cost to our volunteers, if there's a public records request, they go into their private emails, could be pretty substantial.
That's correct.
Are there council questions? Councilmember Sessions?
There was a couple kind of implied questions towards our property tax levy, and I'll just wait to comment on those when we get to that public hearing.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? Let's see, we are at speakers of the audience. Do you have any other question to clarify information provided by another speaker? Mr. Heichel?
Ted Heichel. I don't think I got an answer to the question. And you have that page. It says, the calculation for sewer revenues was erroneously doubled for the biennium. So if the amount that was recorded was $30 million, why is not the amount being brought forward $15 million? There's a difference. Either the sentence that says it was erroneously doubled for the biennium is wrong, or there's something wrong with the calculations of going from 30 million to 22. That's not half of what was on the budget. So I think there's a question there of why, if it was doubled and 30 is doubled, then why is it not 15 million in the correction? Why is it only decreased by 7 million?
Any other audience questions? Van Abishan?
Citizen Lynnwood for 36 years now. Just to follow up on the email issue. I went on the Planning Commission in 2008, and when I did, I brought this issue up at that time, and the city began to issue emails to at least the Planning Commission members at that time. I've been an Exchange Server administrator since 1997. I can tell you right now, to put 60 people on that Exchange Server, if I had the administrative rights, would probably take me somewhere between 20 and 30 minutes. That's if I didn't go for a coffee break. It's a fairly automated system, and doesn't take any time to administrate. It's very simple. And besides that, you've had an awful lot of savings in the IT department because you have failed to hire a new IT director, even though his salary is still in that budget. So that money is there to do that. And as was pointed out by another citizen, $263 or $65 or whatever it was just doesn't add up, period. And to follow up on another citizen's comment, it's time that you folks drop the tax to the max. This has just got to quit. And it's these $15,000 here and $40,000 there and $150,000 here. And pretty soon, as one of the politicians once said, you're talking about real money. And then you have to raise taxes because you have no other choice. Well, you do have another choice. And that is to spend the money that you have properly and to live within your means. That's what these people are asking you to do. And you better start doing it. And by the way, I find it practically underhanded the fact that you're bringing this up after the election. And I assume if had you brought it up before the election, it would probably be a different story tonight. Thank you.
Now, are there others who'd like to speak? Okay. We're closing the hearing. So at this time, since all citizens wishing to speak have had an opportunity to do so, and since participants have had the opportunity to ask questions regarding testimony provided, it's appropriate to close the public hearing. Thank you for being here and participating. So at this time, Council, do you want to make, what action do you want to make? Councilmember Cotton.
Well, I guess it's more of a question. I'm wondering if it's worth following up with Director Springer. Just, I think there was a good comment made about the lack of an IT director position being filled. I wonder if that warrants maybe just a little bit of discussion further, or if that's something Director Springer could maybe answer. I know we've closed it, but to me that was a worthwhile comment to follow up on, that we don't have an IT director with a salary of over $100,000 a year with benefits, and I wonder if this adjustment in cost is an ongoing expense or if this is just the one-time adjustment, which is what we're doing in the budget. So I wonder if it doesn't make sense to maybe...
For the business cards and the like?
Well, I think mostly that cost is the email and the management of the data and the reporting for the public disclosure requirements. So I'm wondering if that doesn't warrant maybe a little bit of time just to have staff maybe look under the hood of that suggestion. But I don't know if that's an actionable thing or if that's...
Well, we do have an interim acting director.
Okay.
Using that salary. And we have interviews for our director Thursday.
So the money is spent. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Sessions?
I don't see any connection with the IT director and this cost that we are incurring here for the emails. But about that email and for the boards and commissions, we did ask about this before as well because it seemed like a high cost. We didn't just not talk about that. So we were curious, and you know, maybe it's something to hear again, maybe from the IT department, exactly why it costs so much. But to clarify that those emails, you know, it can't be a typical Gmail or anything like that because of security reasons. I mean, it just can't be like that. So that's a true statement. But there's other reasons, and with our public open public documents, and there are other reasons. And then, in addition, maybe we wait on this. The reason I say that is because I understand that it's a possibility that maybe we won't need as many as we thought, and so maybe that's something we wait on until we can find out how many we're really going to need or not before we're voting on that.
Or you can just take it out, Vice President?
I would not be in favor of just taking it out, but it seems that it would be prudent to get a breakdown. How much is the actual email cost and the additional security measures that we need to take for that and business, the actual supply items. So perhaps at our work session we could be recipients of that information. And because I do believe that with open public meetings and public records requests that we do need to protect our wonderful volunteers.
Council President?
Would the council be amenable to having that in an FYI? The reason I say that is because, our next work session, November 18th, is legislative engagement night. Then the 20th, which is our next work session, the third Wednesday, is we have that night dedicated for the council to participate in the interviews for the IT director. And we have the TBD meeting as well. So both of those are pretty full of packed meetings. So if we had that in an FYI, we'd still have that information, and then we could make our decision, whatever it may be, on the 25th of November still. And then questions could be, it could be answered by email or at that night on the 25th. Is that?
Yeah, Councilmember Cotton.
That seems like a good process forward. I wonder if procedurally that means we need to move to postpone action until the 24th, or since no motion's on the table, do we just, council leadership takes care of it?
The second, there's no motion on the table, and the materials in the agenda packet indicated that the ordinance was going to be passed on the next council meeting anyway.
Okay.
So. All right. Yes, Councilmember Hurst.
In that FYI, can we just have the clarification on the doubling question on sewer revenue, just to clarify?
Absolutely. I think it was the wrong terminology used in double. That should have been just a miscalculation. Yeah.
All right. Any more discussion on budget modification? Okay. So we'll move on to our next public hearing. This is our public hearing 90.2B for property tax levy for the year 2020. At
At this time, the City Council and I will conduct a public hearing on the city's regular property tax levy for the year 2020. Thank you for attending. The purpose of the public hearing is to allow the public to express their views on matters under consideration by the City Council. Decisions will not be made until after citizens have had the opportunity to share their views. Adopting the city's property tax levy is a legislative action, and common rules for legislative public hearings apply. Public hearings must be fair and free of conflicts of interest before we start the proceedings, and this also applies to myself. Does any council member have any conflict of interest regarding this matter? Thank you. Now the public hearing is officially open. The sequence of tonight's public hearing will be as follows. City staff will provide an oral report that summarizes the matter at hand. The City Council may ask clarifying questions specifically related to staff's presentation or the written information provided. Then members of the audience will be invited to come to the lectern to share information you wish the council to consider. I'll first call on the speakers from the sign-up sheet, and next I will call on speakers who have not signed up. After the public testimony portion of this hearing, I will invite city staff to offer clarifying information responsive to the public comments. The City Council may ask clarifying questions of the speaker specifically related to their testimony, and citizen responses must be made from the lectern. After each citizen has had the opportunity to speak and the City Council is ready to begin its deliberation, I will close the public hearing. After the hearing is closed, the City can begin its deliberation and ultimately determine what action should be taken. As Mayor, it's my role to facilitate the hearing and Council's deliberation. It's important that public hearings are conducted in a manner that is equitable to all. We will use the following ground rules for this public hearing. Written minutes and an electronic recording of this meeting are being made. When coming to the lectern, speakers should state their name and address. Please speak into the microphone so that others can hear you. Comments may only be made from the lectern. Only one person may speak at a time, and speakers will be allowed up to 3 minutes to share their views. When multiple people in the audience are represented by one spokesperson, as demonstrated by a show of hands, the council will consider the testimony to be from each of those persons. If the spokesperson speaks on behalf of the others, I will grant the spokesperson an additional 2 minutes to speak. I may adjust the order of speakers when doing so supports the purpose of this hearing. Everyone's asked to respect opinions that differ from yours and to help ensure members of the audience are not intimidated or discouraged from expressing their views. The purpose of this hearing is to receive citizen input. It's not the time for back and forth discussion or for debate. This public hearing is now underway, and I will ask again Finance Director Sonia Springer to provide an overview of the topic at hand.
Good evening. In the state of Washington, cities are required to adopt via ordinance property tax levies for collection in the next year. This is a public hearing to identify the property tax collection levy for 2020. And this was presented to the Finance Committee, the October meeting, and also at the November 4th work session. This is just a glimpse of the general fund, which is where the property tax levy goes to fund general fund services. And you can see with this pie chart that sales tax represents the most significant portion of the general fund revenue at 42%. Property tax represents 7% of the total general fund revenue. It used to be more like 20-21% before the RFA, but now the city collects about 7% of their revenues for the general fund from property tax. This is a pie chart showing where the expenditures are allocated to the different departments. The police department represents 38% of that pie, and the various departments, different percentages, parks and rec is 15%. So this is where the property tax goes to pay for the services. 2019, the property tax rate for the citizens of Lynnwood is $10.23 per $1,000 of assessed value. And these are the different shares of that $10.23, of which Lynnwood collects this share 57 cents, or 5% of your total property tax bill. Most of the property taxes, you can see from this pie chart, go to the school district, the state schools, and the Edmond School District. There's a portion going to the RFA, And our EMS levy that used to be collected by the City of Lynnwood is now being collected by the RFA. This graph shows the growth, the decline in the earlier years and the growth of the assessed value of the properties in the City of Lynnwood. This county assessor's office has informed us that they expect our assessed value to grow at a rate of 7.47% for 2020. And so they also estimate an increase of over $51 million of new construction that will take the tax burden off the regular taxpayers, the homeowners, because those new construction, the new apartment buildings and so forth, will be paying their fair share of the property tax. And as you can see, the past couple years has been significant growth in assessed value. Last year was 11.85%. And this next year, it's going to be 7.47%. This chart shows a comparison of the property tax levy for 2020 that's being proposed versus what the current property tax levy is in 2019. As you can see, for 2020, we're proposing what's included in the adopted budget, which is $4.4 million. And what's the levy for 2019 was $4 million. So basically, the 2019-20 budget equals $8.4 million of property tax levy in that. So we're not proposing any change from what's in the adopted budget. The difference is $400,000 to collect in 2020 over what we've collected in 2019. And then the next item below the estimated assessed value is per the Snohomish County Assessor's Office. And as I mentioned before, it's about a 7.47% increase from this year's assessed value. And the third line in the middle is what the levy rate is. What it will be is 58 cents per $1,000 of assessed value in 2020. In 2019, it's 57 cents, so that's a 1 cent increase for the rate that City of Lynnwood collects in property taxes. The fourth line down below shows the average value of a home in the City of Lynnwood. We're estimating it's going to increase about 7%. So right now, the average residence is worth about $388,000. We're anticipating that will increase to about $415,000 in 2020. So this extrapolates, it's a math exercise. You see the 58 cents time for the $1,000 of assessed value. So that turns into, so in 2019, currently the average homeowner is paying $221 to the City of Lynnwood for their property tax. And we are proposing what's included in the budget of $242, which is a $21 increase for the year of 2020. This is another chart that shows the history of what's been going on with the levy rate that the city has and the property values. And as you can see, from 2016 on, those property values have gone up. And then the second line shows the levy rate that the City of Lynnwood has collected, and that has gone substantially down. Well, and mostly, well, due to the reason of the RFA, it went from $1.73 in 2017 to 57 cents in 2018, and we're proposing it to go to 58 cents in 2020. So the average annual bill for Lynnwood's portion in 2016 was $508. In 2017, it went up slightly to $515, then it dropped to less than $200 in 2018. This year, in 2019, it's $221, and then in 2020, it's being proposed to be $242, which represents an increase of $21 for the year. You might wonder, how do we compare with our neighbors or other cities, the neighboring cities in the area? So Lynnwood is about middle of the pack, a little bit above at $10.23. and this is according to the Snohomish County Assessor's Office. They put out these statistics every year. And this rate includes, RFA includes all fire services, so it is comparable to all the other cities. And this is the chart chart showing the average residence value for Snohomish County cities, and you can see Lynnwood is right in the middle of $388,000. Mount Lake Terrace is a little bit less, Bothell's a little bit more, Woodway is a lot higher in their property tax values. And when you extrapolate the property tax value and the rate, this is what it turns out to be the average property tax paid per average residence in the Snohomish County cities. And again, Lynnwood is right in the middle at less than $4,000. And then we've got our neighbors, Snohomish and Ocotillo, that are higher. We've got Mount Lake Terrace and Lake Stevens are a little bit lower, but we're right about in the middle of the pack for the total property tax paid by the average homeowner. So the recommendation is to levy a general levy property tax of $4.4 million for 2020, and this translates to 58 cents per $1,000 of assessed value, and it's consistent with the adopted budget and the six-year financial forecast. This amount keeps the general fund balance stable, financially stable, for the next several years, and it's consistent with city's strategic goal number two, which is ensure financial stability and economic success. It represents a $21 increase in property taxes paid to the city of Lynnwood per average residence per year.
Thank you. Council, do you have any questions to clarify information provided during our staff presentation or in the written materials provided in our packets? Councilmember Hurst.
Great. Director Springer, I have some questions on some of the charts. Want to bring those up. The first pie chart. I didn't catch this.
Oh, the first pie chart.
Yeah, I didn't catch this before. Under utility and other taxes, there's not a percentage there. I think if I do a quick math, 48, 49, 50, 61, 68, 69, help me out, 70, 73, 87, about 13%.
I couldn't tell you off the top of my head, but...
But that is, where it says utility and other taxes, so is that, are utility fees or is that utility tax?
Well, it's not utility fees, no.
Yeah, so it's just utility and other...
It's the utility tax that the city collects on cable, telephone, gas, electric, and our own
utilities. Yeah. Okay, great. So I wanted clarification on that chart where you compare, you have the base levy amount for 2019 and 2020. That one. I know there was a figure mentioned by a citizen earlier. In effect, though, in 2019, we had $4 million. It's now going to be $4,400,000. So that is a 10% increase between the 2 years.
It is for the total collection, yes.
Right. And then down below where we talk about the average homeowner getting a $21 increase, which doesn't seem a lot, but if you turn that into percentage, that's like a 9.5% increase in tax.
Yes.
Is that right? Okay. Final question was, if I could find it, I know we, on the average, the total property tax paid by the average residents for Snohomish County cities. And look at those cities. The ones that are higher have a higher median income. We have one of the lowest median incomes in this city. In Everett and I think Gold Bar or something like that. We're the third. So I think when we look and say we're in the middle, I think we also have to pay attention to, anyway, I just want to make that comment that we need to be cognizant of the median income of our citizens, too. Anyway, thank you for those clarifications.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Honor. Director
Director Springer, as part of the RFA exercise, the city of Lynnwood banked a certain amount of capacity of property tax. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And that banked capacity, if you go back to the comparison, maybe back a couple, slightly after the pie charts, right?
The pie charts?
No, go back, sorry. To the one that was, one more? This one.
Yes.
So, the 2018 column where we see a $320 decrease, does that $320 decrease represent the forward rolling banked capacity the city has for what we have to levy total?
It's kind of related to that. All I know is we have about $6 million of banked capacity. Because at that point in 2017, our property tax levy was about $10 million. And now we have four point four.
Okay.
That's a $6 million difference. That's what you call bank capacity. That was our highest lawful levy was in 2017.
Okay.
And that's how that's calculated.
And the state restricts the amount that we can levy every year to 1%.
Above that, yeah.
Above that amount.
Yeah.
Okay. So we're really only increasing a very minimal amount compared to what is on the table.
Yeah, $400,000 of the $6 million that we could, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions, Council? Yeah, Councilmember Sessions.
To clarify again, and kind of adding on to what Councilmember Cotton was saying, can you explain again, remind us the difference of if we were increasing the property tax in general versus a levy and the difference?
The cities in the state of Washington set an amount for a levy, and you determine that as a council body, what amount that should be to collect to cover all of your expenses that you've committed in the budget. And that's why we did the two-year budget. We have $4 million for 19 and 4.4 for 20, and that's the levy amount. Now, when you're talking about the rate, is that what you wanted to know? That's set by the assessor's office, and it's a math calculation between that $4 million or 4.4 divided by the assessed value, and that's how it's calculated. We don't set the rate. We set the amount that needs to be collected by this body to cover your expenses and what you've committed to in the future for financial sustainability.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. And just in general, nobody likes talking about taxes. I think we can all agree on that, for sure. I think one of the reasons why it matters that we do look at our neighbors and we see where the taxes go, I think it's easy to sensationalize taxes. Taxes is a bad word. And so it's real easy for people to sensationalize that and make it worse than it is. And so I just hope that we can keep it just, you know, regular bad, not make it worse bad. So when there's people expressing that it's more of an increase than it is, or that we have the highest property tax in the county, you know, those things are not true. And so I think it's important that that's noted. So thank you for doing that as well.
Vice President Frizzell.
So I wanted to clarify this $400,000 increase. It's not something new for this year. It was already part of the two-year biennium budget. Is that correct?
It was adopted with the two-year biennial budget, and it's in the financial forecast to be sustainable in the future. We must increase taxes a little bit every year to pay for the services that increased.
So we passed a budget including this dollar amount, and we're just kind of putting our stamp of approval that this is what we want to do. We want to follow the budget that we passed already, and this just paves the way to certify that with Snohomish County?
Yes, so they can go ahead and collect it. So the budget includes $8.4 million of property tax revenue for the biennium. We collected $4 million in 19 and collecting 4.4 in 2020. And by setting an ordinance that establishes that amount, that goes to the assessor's office so they can start putting it on the property tax rolls.
Thank you.
Councilmember Hurst.
I remembered the question. The levy rate on assessed value, is that the same for commercial property too?
It is.
Everything's the same.
Yes.
So apartment complexes, everything will.
Yes. That's why new development is really good, because it takes the property tax burden off the homeowners. New buildings, they pay their fair share. They pay the 57 cents per $1,000 of assessed value.
Okay. Thank you.
Other clarifying questions, Council? Councilmember Sessions?
You said you brought this to the Finance Committee before. What was their consensus?
They said to go forward with what was adopted in the budget.
Okay, and the Finance Committee is chaired by Councilmember Hurst and also includes Councilmember Cotton and Council Vice President Frizzell. Thank you.
Other clarifying questions, Council? Any new written materials that we haven't received? So now I'd like to invite our members of the audience to take their turn in sharing their issues with Council. And there's someone who's first on the list, and that would be Julie Anderson. So if you'd like to come forward to the microphone, state your name and address, and you're afforded 3 minutes to address Council.
Good evening. Julie Anderson, 5722 Hill Point Circle. Thank you, Christine. That was a lovely speech. I hope everybody enjoyed as much as I did. It was wonderful. I also wanted to thank everybody else that came up and spoke tonight. I agree with all of you 100%. I think we're on the same page. I had a former state legislator say to me one time, right after he was elected, they went in and did their orientation at state capitol. And they were told that they did not work for the people, that they worked for the state. That was terrifying. I know that the city of Lynnwood is its own corporation, but I would hope that you all always realize that you should be working for the people, not for the corporation. People don't want an increase in property tax. The property tax is probably going to be going down, in my opinion, as far as the income that comes in from it. It looks like the value of our houses are going down, according to Zillow. I just got a notice that my property value, and I realize in the fall it always goes down a little bit, my property value went down $27,000 this last month. So I think we're going to all have to tighten our belts. Everybody does every time the economy goes down. The city shouldn't have to not. Thank you. I think that's it.
Who else would like to speak this evening on the property tax levy? Yes, Mila.
Mila Tanner again. I just had a question. Did you say that you guys every year go up on, it's planned that you go up every year on our taxes? The 4% in your, I thought at the end of your explanation you said that every year you guys go up on our taxes, that is a plan, it's written in the budget. And that kind of caught me off guard a little bit, because if that is the plan every year, that if every year you guys go up on our taxes just to raise the budget or whatever because you guys don't want to tighten your belts, that's ridiculous. I mean, I was
taken aback, but I swear I thought you you said that you guys went up at the end of every year, you go up on the taxes, and that kind of shocked me in the budget. I know that the last couple of years that I've been here in Lynnwood, I've been here 5 years, lived in Lynnwood for the last 5 years, but I was born and raised in this area. And my property taxes have gone up for the last couple of years quite a bit. But I know that my value of my house here in the last year has gone down. So it worries me, just like she said, it worries me that if you go up on my property taxes and then the value of my house goes down, where does that leave me? With where I live, I'm already dealing with enough with the traffic and everything from by the mall. But on top of that, I now have to deal with this. And I just, it just infuriates me that this is, it just, that one part just got me. But I would just hope that there's something else. We can take that money from somewhere else instead of taking it from us that live here. Because this is getting kind of scary to me. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there others who'd like to speak? Yeah, Mark?
Thank you, Mayor. Mark Drecke, 204-03, 63rd Place West in Lynnwood. Just as a point of reference, I want to clarify. It wasn't stated that we had the highest taxes. It was stated that we had the highest sales taxes, which is a true statement. And as a secondary topic, we all understand that the city is not the only source of tax burden on our properties. And perhaps some of you know that today at Snohomish County, there is a vote for a tax raise for Snohomish County. I don't know how that vote went out, but that's also on the table. And when you add to that the burden from ST3, and you add to that burden from the fire district, which was, at least as I understood it, supposed to be a savings to us as we sold off all of our beautiful equipment, and it's very concerning to me. And taxes are increasing at an unsustainable rate. And in the meantime, our general fund is decreasing. And so this may be a stopgap, and you may have no choice, but I strongly urge all of you to look at your oaths of office and to whom you do serve. And it's the constituents of Lynnwood. And I would greatly appreciate that consideration. Thank you.
Mr. Heckel?
It's a couple back. No. Next one. That one. Ted Heichel, 3821 91st Place Southwest in Lynnwood. If you look at the top of that chart, the top line, it says that in 2016, property values went up almost 10%, over 9% in 17, 14% in 18, 14 in 19, and they'll only go up another 7% in 2020. That's the estimate. My income didn't go up 9 or 10% or 14%. Your taxes went up last year. Well, when the RFA came into and we had Sound Transit come on, our taxes in 1 year went up 24%. Total tax went up 24%. Last year you raised 11%. This year you're planning 10%. I asked you, does the cost of doing business in the city go above the 2 to 3% that most economists say business in the city should go up? Now, I realize you've got a lot of high-priced people here. You've got department heads that are making probably between, most of them, between $150,000 and $200,000 a year, which is way beyond what any of the people in most of the city earn and who own those houses that went up. It doesn't matter to me how much value the house that I live in goes up unless I sell it and move. So you're looking at a 10% increase this year. And a lot of our taxes on property come from the business community. If you look at those other cities, that how many other cities have anywhere near the commercial property that we have? And that's a burden on the businesses. You just honored a business tonight. His property taxes are going to go up if you vote for this another 10%. Where is the point where you say, you know what? We're going to look at the city financial policies that we just passed tonight. And it says in there that an alternative to raising taxes would be cutting something out of the budget. Now you've got, what, $65 million budget or something in that realm? You tell me you can't cut out $400,000 out of that budget? If you can't do it now, you sure as shooting are going to have to do it once the next recession comes along. Some of us lived through that recession and lived through what it meant to the city of how we had to cut way back on lots of stuff. Maybe this would be an exercise for you to find out how you do have to cut back at times. Councilmember Frizzell mentioned that this was all baked into the biennial budget, and it sort of made me feel like, what are we doing here tonight if this is only a pro forma hearing, that the decision has already been decided? I hope that's not true. I hope that you will go back, and in the 2 weeks before this has to be done and sent to the county, you consider what would it mean for us to cut back $400,000 out of our $65 million budget.
Others, yeah. Carrie?
Carrie Lonergan-Drakey. Boy, it's going to be tough for me to beat comments there by former council member Ted Heichel. He very eloquently said what I will also say, and that is, since 2015, our property taxes have increased 30%. Now, a big chunk of that is from that wonderful vote that the council took on the RFA, which the net of that was probably a $500 to $600 a year increase in our property taxes. For what? The same level of service? So we could give all the firefighters a great raise that we're all paying for? Now, I love firefighters, but you know, at some point, we have to be doing what's best for the people. I don't think that was very wise. I am still ticked about that, and I hold each of you that took that vote personally accountable. I hope someday that comes back to bite you. Since I left this council in 2013, every year these councils have voted to raise our property taxes. I don't know what other city in Snohomish County has done that. I have a business in the city of Everett. They have a huge budget deficit right now, and in the last year or two, they have not voted to increase taxes. And yet we've got the city of Lynnwood with huge increases in revenue during this economic boom. And where is the belt tightening? I don't see it at all. I just see a continued thirst to raise taxes and burden the citizens of Lynnwood. Now, in my house, the increase in property tax is significant. But for a lot of people in the city,
they have to make a choice about what they're going to do without because of that. So it really, it's very frustrating to see this council year after year not tighten its belt. And I think former Councilmember Ted Heichel brings up a good point, and that is we've got to be fiscally responsible and do the right thing for our residents. Now, I loved the one council member earlier tonight who waxed on about the importance of realizing that it's from the people to the electeds. Well, I hear a lot of people in this room tonight saying we do not want any more property taxes, and yet at the same time, I'm also hearing that this is kind of a faux hearing tonight, that you've already baked these property taxes into your budget. It's like, why are we here wasting our time, and what kind of credibility does this give to the whole budgeting process in this city? Very disturbing. Back to cities and county that have not raised their taxes in some time. Mill Creek, they're very frugal. They're not raising their property taxes every year because they can and they have bank capacity. They're looking to be fiscally responsible and keep taxes low. Thank you.
Anybody else like to speak? Van Abishan?
Van Abishan, I've been in the city for 36 years and the last 2 hours, I think. We want to talk about the effects of the RFA. And you on the council who were responsible for this move, you know who you are. The RFA, one of the things that you did in the RFA that you voted to do, and that was to give the new jurisdiction all of our property, our taxpayers' property. The piece of property over here and the piece of property at 68th and 188. Gave it to them. Free. Here we are. Quick claim deed. Adios. Thank you very much. I suggest to you, had we raised a situation with them and said, look, we're not going to give you this property. We're going to lease you this property and these buildings for some amount of money. And over that period of time, I guarantee you, had we done that at a market rate, we wouldn't be standing here quibbling about $400,000 in property taxes tonight. We will be looking at banking properties taxes for this next biennium because we would have had that revenue. But now, you, and you know who you are, decided to give that property away. Well, now I hope you go home tonight and sleep real well on that decision. Thank you.
Who else? Yes, sir.
Judson.
Hi. Hi, Mayor. Hello, Council. Judson again at 19027 40th, just down the street. I can almost see it from here. Wanted to talk a little bit about some of the numbers that we were presented with tonight. We are looking at a proposed about 7.4 something or other percent increase in property value predicted for 2020. About 11.85% the year before that. As the property value assessment increases, so does the tax that we pay anyhow. And so to levy something over and above that, it's kind of a double hit, it's a double whammy. And that's something that I do believe is unjust and unfair. We're looking at that $400,000 as compared to a budget of $65 million, I might be wrong, but around 1.6%. You know, like, so we're saying, you know, hey, we're gonna increase, you know, your property taxes by just this tiny amount. And I'm saying, can't we reduce some kind of spending by an even smaller amount? it was said that it's $3,967 per house, per average house in the city of Lynnwood per year, property taxes right now, plus sales tax, plus the tabs that have doubled on all of my vehicles, plus all the other tax burden that all of us as taxpayers have to pay to every other municipality who wants to reach in my pocket and take it. I was actually shocked when recently I sent an invoice to a client of mine that is on the top of one of the tallest buildings in Seattle's skyline. And I was shocked when I calculated their sales tax to be so much less than what I pay here in the city of Lynnwood. It's also come to my attention to realize that we make strategic decisions when we do major purchases, and that strategic decision is to shop outside the city of Lynnwood to save on the sales tax. It just seems worth it to us on a major purchase. And one thing that was justified as a reason why we should increase this and have this levy is so that we can increase services. I would propose that we not increase the services. Instead, let's increase wisdom. Let's increase in responsibility. We're adults. This is part of what we have to do. This is our mandate, and it's your mandate as the council who serves the citizens of the city to have to be responsible to the citizens, and that means financially responsible. On top of all this, we have more homes being built, more apartments being built. That's going to be an increase in revenue as those buildings are built and as those property values are assessed and as those residents move in. And all the businesses that we have, one of the busiest places of commerce in the North Sound area here with the mall and all the other things that happen, we know that. I've read some statistics that suggest that our population of the city doubles during the daytime hours. And yet with all of that, we can't seem to balance a budget. And I've closed with this final thought. The city that gets to spend the revenue that they're voting to approve is like two wolves and a sheep voting on what's for dinner. I would propose to you not to increase the levy, and I would propose to you to tighten the belt and cut some taxes, because every citizen who's spoken on this issue tonight has asked you to do so. Thank you.
Others? Anyone else? All right. Director Springer, do you wish to offer any clarifying information in response to the citizen testimony?
Yes, I wanted to address the woman who is questioning if we raise property taxes every year. We have to levy property taxes every year, and that amount is determined based on our financial forecasts and our budget. As you can see here in 2018, our property tax was decreased substantially by $320. So it's not always increased every year. It's a decision that's made on a yearly basis by every single city in the state of Washington and every single county on what that property tax levy needs to be for the following year. It's not always necessarily an increase. Just wanted to address that.
Council, do you have questions? Councilor Cotton?
Director Springer, we use a budgeting for outcomes methodology for developing a biennial budget, is that correct?
Yes, we do.
And as part of that process, every city department provides a business plan for every service they want to provide to the residents for the cost, and part of the biennial process is that they present that service that they want to present the cost at the time of the biennial budget, is that correct?
That's correct.
And the city of Seattle, the city of Lynnwood doesn't have a B&O tax for its businesses, is that correct?
That's correct.
Let's see here, what are some other things here? I'm hearing some things in the audience, and I want to make sure that I'm asking you questions that answer some of those, I hope. As part of the biennial budget process where we go through BFO, staff presents a number of services, and is it true that, I know leading the witness low here, is it true that not every service presented by staff or by city departments gets included in that biennial budget?
Correct, especially early on when the budget is being developed, it goes through a BFO exercise to prioritize the programs and the outcomes.
Okay, that's all my line of questioning for right now. Thank you.
Councilmember Sessions?
Thank you. So, Dr. Director Springer, can you tell us what happens if we don't approve this increase in the levy?
We will need to identify reductions of expenditures in the budget or offsetting revenues to accommodate that, because otherwise we will be below our financial reserve requirements, which is 2.5 months of operating expenditures in the reserve balance. That will dip below that if we don't either reduce expenditures or find revenue elsewhere.
And how much money of expenditures would we have to reduce?
$400,000.
And how does this affect us the year later? Or the year later?
You mean after 2020?
Mm-hmm. 2021, 2022.
Every year is a different year, so the council decides how much property tax to levy every year. So we do a forecast based on sales tax and our general revenues that we receive, and property tax too. So those expenditures, those budgeting for outcomes, those programs are based on those revenues. So if there's a dip in one of those revenues, we need to reduce the expenditures.
And by not approving the levy in this year, does that affect for 2020? I mean, 2021, 2022. I know you keep saying it's the council's decision, but as far as does it affect it, like puts us behind?
No. Okay. Every year is different.
Okay.
Depending on the needs. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Hurst?
Director Springer, how much has the city earned in interest on their investments this year?
Almost $1 million so far, for citywide, yeah.
Was that anticipated revenue?
A lot of it was. Some of it is in excess of that. Not necessarily general fund. A lot of that $1 million is going to the utilities because of the bond issue that was lit last year, so there's extra funds in there being invested. So the general fund has not earned anywhere near $1 million. It's the ETA fund has earned some interest, but not the general fund.
Right. But so we are earning, though, on our investments. I mean, it's...
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was, so far this year, $1.3 million. Is that correct?
It could be. I don't...
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions, Council? Do any of the speakers from the audience have a question to clarify information provided by any other speaker? No new information. Question? Mr. Heichel?
From what Director Springer said, there was this big drop in taxes in Lynnwood from going from 2017 to 2018. But, Director Springer, was that not because the RFA came in and the combined rate of taxes between the RFA tax and the city did increase property taxes? The combined total was an increase in property tax for the citizens of Lynnwood. You can say there was a decline, but the decline was only in what the city took, but the city combined with the RFA, was it not even more than we had been paying the year before, and I believe it was. It's just like the increase in the water sewer rates. They go up every year. There's a plan for it, a 5-year plan, 6-year plan, but that also means there's a 6% increase, there's a 6% tax on that water and sewer and stormwater. That also raises more dollars when you have a 6% tax on top of the increases that the water and sewer rates are adding on to it. So it's like a rolling stone that never stops. It never gathers any moss. It just keeps rolling more taxes down the line. And until you come to the point where you're going to say, at least let us take a look at what it would mean to cut $400,000 out
of the current projected budget. Until you do that, you'll never know what could be done. You'll only know it's just more tax money.
Any other audience? Judson and then Mark. Yeah, these are clarifying questions.
Mm-hmm. Is there a chance, actually going back to that last document that we were just looking at, is there a chance we could actually see what those figures actually go off of as far where it says excludes EMS? So the bottom line as far as what residents feel is including that EMS. So I'd be really curious to see if we could get clarification on what those bottom line totals are including EMS to kind of also clarify Mr. Heckel's question. Thank you.
Mark Durkee.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. Perhaps an echo of the pastor's comment. Yeah, I would like to see clarification of the RFA's impact. In fact, it would be really great because we're all also Snohomish County residents for the council's information to see what is the true burden and change each year. It's great to say, wow, didn't we do a great job in 2018? We decreased taxes. But as Mr. Heckel pointed out, it was a net increase. And when you start to add on the county taxes, the ST3, the RFA, I'd like to see a couple more lines in that chart that shows what the true burden is assessed to each of your constituents. And I think you'd want to see that too. Thank you.
Any other clarifying questions? Mila?
My thing, honestly, is tax, levy. Levy is still a tax, correct? It's still a tax. You're still going up on my taxes. My bottom line is it's still a tax, and that's where I'm confused. I was confused with the whole entire thing because, honestly, my taxes still went up. When I go to pay my house taxes at the end of the year or on April 30th or April 1st and then October 31st or whatever, those still go up. And when I ask why they went up, it was because of the city of Lynnwood. They don't call them a levy, they call them taxes. So whether it's a levy or a tax, still a tax, right? So I get it, I just need you guys just to keep it the way it is. You know what I'm saying? Just tell me flatly what it is. When I asked, that's why I was asking. But that's frustrating to me. And I get it when Mr. Cotton was saying whatever about all the B&O or what King County, all the other counties. We're not worried about all that. We're worried about right here in Lynnwood. We're not worried about Mount Lake Terrace. We're not worried about any other city. We're just worried about right here because this is where we live. This is where we have to pay taxes. So this is where we need to focus. Seriously. It's frustrating.
Ted?
I have a question for council members Frizzell and Goodwin, who serve on the RFA board. I have been to their meetings recently, and it is my recollection, and please tell me if I'm correct or not, but the RFA has announced that they will not increase their tax rate for the coming year.
Any other audience questions to clarify what's already on the table? Okay. So at this time, all citizens wishing to speak have had the opportunity to do so, and since participants have had the opportunity to ask questions regarding testimony provided, it's appropriate to close the public hearing. Thank you very much for for being here this evening. Council, it's your time for any deliberation that you want to have. Vice President Frizzell?
I'll jump in regarding the RFA. And we are in the middle of budgeting for the RFA, and I don't have those numbers at my fingertips for this meeting, but I can certainly get back to you about those numbers. I don't recall them saying, making a statement about not raising or or lowering by a certain percent. We're in the middle of working through that budget time, and they have an annual budget, so we'll know soon, and I can get you that information.
Anything else, Council? Councilmember Hurst?
Sure. Yeah, I'd like to just clarify some things. The Finance Committee did have a presentation on this tax levy, and there was no recommendation by the committee at all. In fact, we can't vote as far as decisions that this council makes in that committee. So we read the information and forward it on. My comment is somewhat jaded because I voted against this budget that included this tax increase, and I do believe I'm very sympathetic with the taxpayers out there that this is the time to hold the line. We can do it. I suggest that's we're going to be voting on this in 2 weeks, but that's certainly where I'm heading. Thank you.
Councilmember Sessions?
I just wanted to clarify, when we'll be voting on this?
This is scheduled for adoption of an ordinance on November 25th, which is a Monday. It has to be sent to the county by November 27th, or there will be no tax levy in 2020. It has to be voted on the 25th, the latest. Yeah.
Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton?
Thank you, Honor. Director Springer, if you would go to the pie chart that shows general fund expenditure budget, the one that shows the 38% for the police department. So, since this is our time for deliberation, but we're not taking action necessarily tonight, I want to explain a little bit philosophically the approach, because I take very seriously the oath of office and that I do serve the voters. To me, that means looking at, not to be cute, but the whole thing here. The city does a lot of essential services and performs a lot of essential functions. Your toilet's flush because the city adequately and appropriately budgets for that. Our jail system is not overly burdensome because we adequately manage that and pay for that. And we have a matrix study that says we have one of the best police departments in the region. In fact, there are stories that just don't get told, and one of them I'll tell you tonight. In 2015, a person who is not in the right mind walked into the Lynnwood Library with a shotgun. The police officer on duty in the back room walked out, de-escalated, and it had that person disarm themselves without a shot being fired. You didn't hear about it because our excellently trained police department de-escalated that situation and no one died. That's your tax dollars at work. So when I look at the whole ecosystem of taxes being paid, and trust me, I pay these taxes too. I see the bottom line every monthly check that I write to the mortgage company and the piece that goes to taxes and escrow. And my parents are retired in this community, so trust me, I hear from them too when their costs go up. The thing that I struggle with is we get asked to not raise taxes, but the cost of things does not go down. The cost of pavement to cover the roads goes up. The cost of labor to pay people to do the work on those roads goes up. If we don't incrementally move the line a little bit, what happened in 2013 in response to the recession was, and 2012, was a tax to the max, where the city didn't have a plan, which was why I wanted to bring our financial policies out, because we have a plan now so that we're not taxing to the max. I also wanted to bring up the fact that we have a total of $6 million bank capacity. We're only asking for $400,000. If we don't, in my mind, my duty to you is to try and move the needle just enough in every way so that we pay for the things that you've asked for. And every election season, all I hear is we need more police. So we've got it. We've got what you've asked for, because that's what I've heard. So if, in my mind, if I'm the public, if I'm your steward sitting up here and you're asking me not to raise taxes, I also need to look at services I reduce. So, but I'm also trusting staff that no one in staff is telling me we don't offer non-essential services. So philosophically, that's how I approach this. And I take it very, I don't shoulder this burden lightly. I'm a little over my time here, but this is important to me that you understand this and hear this from me, because I pay these taxes too. My parents are retired in this community. They pay these taxes on a fixed income as well. I understand the burden across and the spectrum here. But if I don't, sitting here just as one of seven, if I don't consider making incremental changes, we defer those costs to the point to where we have structural failure. And that, to me, is concerning. So I'll relinquish the dice, but that's, and because I hear you, and it is important to me that you hear that I am your servant up here, and part of that is just seeing the whole ecosystem of the city's economics, so thank you.
Any other council comments? Vice President Frizzell?
I wanted to add to what Councilmember Cotton has spoken about. As people were talking, we want taxes lowered, we want to pay less. Let me ask you, you know, where do we cut? Do we get rid of police officers? And please put your hand down. It's a rhetorical question. As I'm sitting here, we can easily go, oh yeah, we don't need that, we don't need that, we don't need that. But what we don't do when we make quick decisions like that is we don't understand the ramifications of it. Those of us that sit on the finance team, we get into some of those ramifications. And it's our job up here not to make those fast decisions based upon emotion. But let me tell you, we hear you. I would be more than happy to sit down with somebody and let's talk about it. Let's understand where the numbers are coming from. Let's understand the difference between a levy and a tax or whatever. We don't want to be up here raising taxes, but we do want to do is to create a community that is taking care of one another. And I'm just going to leave it at that,
Anything else, Council? Okay. Thank you, everybody, for participating today. Council, do you have the energy without having a break to take care of 90.3A and the new business topic of your the ad hoc? Can we stay at the dais for that? Okay. So under 90.3, other business items, this is the salary commission ordinance and related cleanup. Is there a council member who would like to put that on the table?
Okay.
Councilmember Cotton.
Ordinance number, please.
3348.
3348. Correct. Ooh, this one's a mouthful. What did I get myself into? Ordinance, I move ordinance number 3348, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, establishing a salary commission to set the annual salaries for the city's elected officials, adding a new chapter 2.98 to the Lynnwood Municipal Code, retitling chapter 2.04 of the Lynnwood Municipal Code, adding new sections 2.04.072, 2.04.073, 2.04.074, and 2.04.075 to the Lynnwood Municipal Code, amending sections 2.10.030 of the Lynnwood Municipal Code, adding new sections 2.10.040 and 2.10.050 to the Lynnwood Municipal Code, amending sections 2.48.010 of the Lynnwood Municipal Code, repealing sections 2.48.190, 2.48.192, 2.48.193, and 2.48.194 of the Lynnwood Municipal Code, and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second.
Would you like to speak to the ordinance, Councilmember Cotton?
Yes, Your Honor, thank you. There are some aspects of this that I don't necessarily agree with entirely. I do like the fact that we are trying again to give back to you the power to tell us what we're worth. And so, should this commission be formed, it'd be a great opportunity for you to go and say, you know, why don't you save us $100,000 a year or whatever it costs to have this body, and let's put that towards emails and business cards or whatever. So I'm excited because of the principle. There's some things structurally that I would have liked to see different, but all in all, I think the changes are agreeable. Thank you.
Councilmember Sessions.
I just have a clarification question, if I could. There was a question regarding citizen input at the meetings. Who am I addressing this question to?
Director Chin.
I'm sorry, what's the question?
Earlier, you weren't here. There was a comment regarding why can't citizens ask questions at any of the meetings versus, is it only when there's going to be a change or what?
No, it's an open public meeting. The meeting of the Salary Commission is an open public meeting like any other open public meeting. Citizens would be allowed to comment.
Citizens can ask questions at every meeting?
It's an open public meeting. The meeting of the Salary Commission is an open public meeting.
So just to clarify, an open public meeting is not the same thing as people allowed to ask questions at it. For example, our business meetings, we have citizen comments. Our work sessions, both are open public meetings, but we don't allow citizen comments currently at work sessions. So I just want to clarify, can citizens ask questions at all the meetings?
Well, I can answer that. The way the ordinance is written right now, it would not be necessarily required, but it would be up to the commission to decide whether or not to have a public comment period on their agenda.
Thank you. That satisfies me. Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton.
So I think, and thank you, Councilmember Sessions, actually, because I entirely forgotten about that part earlier because of the impassioned discussions about taxes. I think it's on 90.3A5, section 2.98.050, the open meetings portion, starting on line 42. I think the piece is, so all meetings, actions, hearings, and business of the commission shall be subject to the Open Public Meetings Act and set forth in chapter 42.30 of the RCW prior to the filing of any salary. Go to the next page. Schedule. The commission shall hold no fewer than two public hearings thereon within the months immediately preceding the filing of the salary schedule. I wonder, could we amend that to just say all meetings of the commission shall allow for public comment? could we amend it as such, and then it would just require that whenever the commission meets, they would have an open public comment section?
You could, but that's different than having a public hearing. That's, public hearings implies that there's going to be special notice put out to the public that, you know, that there's a specific time when they're going to come and comment on the proposed salaries.
I understand that, and I appreciate the clarification. The reason why I'm wondering is because that section 2.99.050 just talks about open meetings. It doesn't necessarily specify that it's just for the public hearings. It's just saying that the commission shall hold no fewer than two public hearings, therefore thereon within the 2 months immediately preceding the filing of its salary schedule. So I guess maybe Director Chen, if you is this only intended, is this commission only intended to meet whenever they are being instructed to review salaries, or will they have regularly scheduled meetings? Sorry, Director Chen.
Yeah, I think they can have regularly scheduled meetings. They're supposed to meet at the beginning of the biennial budget year.
Okay.
That's the intent, so that they can help determine what the salaries are, so that they could get entered into the budget, and so that there can be some accounting for the salaries of the city council and the mayor.
So the intent is that this would be a commission that meets for just hypotheticals here, of course. I know that this will get quoted a year from now, but hypothetically this commission would just meet for, say, 3 months during that process, and then would not meet again until it was called upon.
They may request to meet at any time. The chair may request a meeting at any time, but the intent is to have the meetings done and set so that the salaries can be entered into the budget, like I said earlier.
Okay, thank you. So I guess back to Attorney Larson, would it be okay to amend this on starting on line 2 of page 90.3A6 to say all meetings shall allow for public comment?
Yeah, the RCW doesn't specifically address that. I don't see any reason why you couldn't say that.
Okay.
I actually don't know of any other city that has done that, though, for what that's worth.
Well, all right. Well, then I'll have it a go since I've got the floor. I move to amend Ordinance 3348 as follows. On line 2 of page 90.3.A-6, add the sentence, all meetings shall allow for a public comment.
Second.
Any discussion? Councilmember Ross?
I think it's more appropriate to let the commission make that decision.
Council Vice President?
I'm not following what chapter and verse you're on.
Oh, sorry. So it's on line 2 of page 90.3-A-6. We're talking about amendment to section. Yeah, sorry. Okay. And then just so you, just since you asked the question, adding another sentence to the end that just says all meetings shall allow for public comment.
Okay. I think that there's some ambiguity here because in section 2.98.040, it speaks about the commission shall meet between January 1 and April 30th. And you were saying that they could meet at other times. And I'm just a little confused as to when the commission is meeting and what will be their scope as far as having members of the community speak at those meetings.
Are you asking me?
Director Chen, did you have a response?
I'm not sure that I understand the question exactly.
C- Councilmember Cotton mentioned that the commission could have meetings anytime. And I was a little confused by that because it shows January 1 to April 30th. And to me, there's some ambiguity there as far as when the commission can meet and when citizen comments can be taken.
I believe Director Chin said that they could call a meeting anytime. I didn't say that.
Yeah, I was looking at Section B of that, that the meetings may be scheduled by the chair of the commission or by a majority vote of the commission. I believe the original intent is to have the meetings at the beginning of the year from the 1st of January through April 30th, but that review time schedule can be also extended by a request of the commission and approval of the council. So, for instance, if they needed more time beyond the 30th, that they mm-hmm. could have that.
Done? Yes. Councilmember Sessions.
And just to clarify for those who are listening, this salary commission isn't for all the employees of the city. It's only for elected officials. So I think it's important to note that. We really didn't bring that up. That it's just for us because we can't make those decisions on our own. So elected officials. So that's what this is regarding. And it makes sense. Common sense, particularly, of why it would be necessary to figure these things out at the beginning of a budget year. And so, anyway, that's what we're talking about here. It doesn't get more. It's just that simple.
President Goodwin.
Thank you. I also am of the mind that this should be a decision of the commission itself. One of the reasons is because I think the more that council gets its hands into it, the more ambiguities that could arise. So I think it would be a good idea for the commission to go about however they want to, whether they want to allow public comments in their meetings. But I also have the concern as we put more and more amendments into items like this, we don't know the ripple effect that has in other parts of said ordinance or the charge that the commission has. So I would be of the mind that it's best to leave that up to the commission and allow them, if they want to make that determination, to accept public comment or to have more than two public hearings, you know, whatever it is, I think that should be up to them.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. Philosophically, I am unafraid to make changes to law on the dais because I see that as my job. I know that that's not necessarily shared up here. I don't know that there's a whole lot of scary ripple effects of adding a sentence, and this just hits a nerve with me because I think this is, I take this as my job is to make changes. So anyway, I'm sorry it's late, so I'm being a little snarky. But anyway, I don't think that there are any kind of crazy negative, catastrophic failure type elements that might occur if we just add all meetings shall allow for public comment, but I'm just one of seven.
Any more discussion? I think we better have a roll count.
On the amendment?
On the amendment.
On the amendment.
So roll count on the amendment to add all meetings shall allow for public comment under 2.98.050.
Yes.
Okay. Councilmember Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Cotton?
Yes.
Council Vice President Frizzell?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Nope.
Councilmember Hurst?
Yes.
Councilmember Ross?
No.
5 yes, 2 no.
All right. That amendment has passed. We're back to the initial motion.
Mm-hmm.
Any more discussion on the initial motion? No? Okay, we're okay. Ready for that roll call vote, please.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
Councilmember Ross?
Yes.
Councilmember Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Cotton?
Affirmative.
Council Vice President Frizzell?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Aye.
7 yes, Mayor.
All Thank you. Ordinance number 3348 passes unanimously. Time is ticking close to 10 o'clock. Do you want to, I want to pass the running of the meeting over to Council President for new business with regard to the homeless or the housing task force. You need more than 5 minutes.
I can never really tell.
No.
I myself probably not. But
we should still do it anyway. Stay to the end of our executive session. So someone make a motion to that.
Move to extend to the completion of businesses scheduled on the agenda.
Second.
Second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you, and thank you for your patience. Sorry. Okay, Council President, new business, housing ad hoc task force.
All right, so I was tasked with forming an ad hoc committee with a specific purpose to draft a low-income resident displacement ordinance. So I have done what I said that I would do last week, came to this meeting prepared to state the committee, who will be on the committee, as well as the charge of the committee. So the committee will be made up of 7 individuals. There are 5 right now that have confirmed, 2 are still in the process. So the 5 confirmed will be Chris Collier, Kim Toski, George Hurst, Mindy Woods, and Chris Boyer. The charge for the ad hoc committee is to draft an outline of a City of Lynnwood housing policy with a specific focus on a low-income resident displacement ordinance. The ordinance to be presented to the City Council on December 9th, as long as the outline of the City of Lynnwood housing policy. So the outline is, again, just a very basic outline of a housing policy with a draft of a low-income resident displacement ordinance. The chair and the other 2 members to be determined at a later date this week once I have confirmation of the other 2 people that they can and will serve on that committee.
All right. Okay. All right, Council, why don't you take a 5-minute break as you move to the executive room. We will now hold 2 executive sessions. The first one is on property acquisition and potential litigation, and we're asking to start that with 10 minutes, and depending on how many questions you have, that might extend. And then we'll move right into executive session for AFSCME labor negotiations. And I think starting with 10 minutes, and we'll come back out if we need more.
I got to put it on the action.
Thank you. And we're adjourning from the executive session.
Thank you.